Hey, I'm Danny Benjamin. I'm Distinguished Professor of Pediatrics at Duke University. And I want to talk about clinical research in a pandemic and the unique opportunity to establish a primary endpoint. So whenever we're doing studies, we need to have a primary outcome or primary endpoint, and we need to have a primary exposure. And I want to talk with you a little bit about thinking through endpoints, and in particular primary endpoints, especially for something where no one has thought through it before. So in March of 2020, there was a hypothesis that children, if they attended school, would fuel the pandemic. And therefore, many folks believe that schools should be closed and shut down and go to remote learning. In July of 2020, most schools would be closed in the fall of 2020, and we didn't know if schools would be open that summer. And much of that depended on whether or not your child went to public, charter, or private school and what part of the country they were in. But most children underwent remote learning in the fall of 2020. And in July of 2020, I was approached based on my history of working with a local school district by a pediatrician who was a school board member at Chapel Hill Carborough City Schools. And Dr. Fowler asked me if I'd talk with her some about metrics for reopening. I said, you know, really, rather than metrics, maybe we could set up a collaboration where we could serve to answer some medical questions for you, and you all could kind of fit that into public policy, because we certainly know the medicine, but we are not experts in education or education policy. That was amenable to that particular school board. The following week, three or four area school districts in Central North Carolina heard of what we were doing. They approached us. By August of 2020, the State Superintendent Association leadership reached out to us. And there are 115 school districts in the state of North Carolina. And by mid-August, 50 of those 115 were working with us. And we decided, gosh, we've really got something here. We'll give it a name. We called it the ABC Science Collaborative. Now, we really didn't start out by thinking, hey, we're going to define research. We started out by saying, hey, we're clinicians who want to be able to help. But we quickly came to think of the pandemic and reopening schools as much like we were experiencing patient care. That is, if a patient needed to be intubated and they had real symptoms of SARS-CoV-2, we knew we had to gown up and mask and gloves and protect our eyes. The list goes on and on with N95 masks. We knew that from the spring, but we also knew from the spring of 2020 that most routine healthcare interactions, whether or not you were interacting with the patient in your office or seeing an asymptomatic patient for routine tests, that we were wearing surgical masks and sometimes cloth masks, and as were our patients, and we were able to draw blood and do physical exams and put in IVs just using a regular surgical mask without transmitting SARS-CoV-2 or COVID to our patients. And we weren't getting it from our patients if we were listening to them with a stethoscope. And we felt like if we could put in an IV and not transmit COVID to our patients, that somebody could teach algebra and not transmit it to their patients or their school children, rather, and not have school children transmitted to them. And so our counter hypothesis was, gosh, maybe you're not gonna transmit and maybe children won't feel the pandemic. Now, when you're in the healthcare setting, hand washing is key to patient care because it prevents transmission of infection between healthcare provider and patient. And you wash your hands before and after seeing every patient. However, hand washing in the hospital at, say, Duke University does not have a substantial impact on infections in the state of North Carolina. it simply interrupts transmission of infection at Duke Hospital. Likewise, hand washing at UCLA interrupts transmission of infection at University of California, Los Angeles hospital system, but it does not have a huge impact on the 10 million people who live in LA County, only those who are in the hospital. So we said, okay, what we'll do is we'll look at the primary endpoint will be, does there have SARS-CoV-2 transmission in schools if we mask or if we don't mask? And our key outcome is going to be, do we get SARS-CoV-2 at school? And we assess that through contact tracing and by testing. And our exposure is, do we mask or not mask? So our primary exposure, our primary intervention is, do we mask or not mask? That's our primary intervention. And our primary outcome is not how much COVID is there in North Carolina, but rather how much COVID is transmitted at school. Now, what we did not know in the fall of 2020 was what we were seeing that worked so well in healthcare, would that work in schools? We didn't know if schools would enforce masking. We knew we were enforcing masking in the hospital and in the clinics and in the public health departments. If we saw you without your mask on, we told you to put your mask on, but we didn't know if schools would do that. And we didn't know if children would follow instructions. It turns out that the kids actually followed instructions. Great. Sometimes the adults needed a little bit of coaching in the schools, but the kids followed the instructions great. And actually compliance was fantastic. But we had a natural experiment occur in that about one third of schools opened and only about one third of schools were closed in September, but they were open by the end of the first quarter of instruction. And about one third of schools stayed closed through the first two quarters of instruction. So we had this great natural experiment and we could see sequentially what happened. And we could answer questions that really mattered the most to schools, like what happens when children get on school buses? Is school busing safe? What happens with new variants? What happens when some schools stay open and some schools close? So as we established the primary endpoint, we thought about hand washing in hospitals, and hand washing in hospitals doesn't reduce infection rates across the country or across a county. And masking in schools is pretty much the same. It doesn't have a huge impact at how many people experience COVID in the state, but it has a tremendous amount of impact on, will I get COVID as a result of going to school? And why is that so important? Well, we want schools to be open for all people, including children who are immune compromised or maybe have had a heart transplant or maybe getting chemotherapy. We also want them to be safe and to prevent transmission there for teachers, some of whom are either themselves immune compromised or have immune compromised people at home. And so we want a safe work environment for the adults. And if they choose to engage in higher risk activities outside of school, that's their prerogative. We just don't want them giving COVID to each other at their place of employment. And children might engage in after school activities with other children where they might get COVID. That's their choice. But while they're in school, which is a mandatory activity, we don't want them transmitting COVID at school. And this natural study where one third were open, we actually got on the phone every week with all the superintendents that were participating. And there were 11 school districts that were opened, over 100,000 schools. Students and staff at these schools attended in-person learning for the first 9 weeks of instruction. And we had almost 800 community-acquired SARS-CoV-2 infections were documented by molecular testing. And we anticipated, based on the natural transmission rate of SARS-CoV-2, to have over 1,000 secondary infections or within school transmission. But through contact tracing and North Carolina Health Department staff determinations, of subsequent infection confirmed by testing, there were only an additional 32 infections that were acquired within school. And at this moment, late in 2020, we knew that if you masked in schools, you were going to have a very, very low rate of transmission of SARS-CoV-2 in schools, and that we could safely open schools in the pandemic. And we knew this by December of 2020 and January of 2021, when we published this paper. And so we knew that we could safely deliver education in a pandemic because we had the primary endpoint, which is within school transmission of COVID. We had the primary intervention, which is masking. And we had a group of people with high compliance and dedication to child safety, that is the school leaders working on the ground and in partnership with some medical advice from some physicians. And these tables here just summarize some of the results. The top table shows you a middle school that the weeks that it was open, and we would record how many, the health department workers would record how many primary cases there were, and then how many secondary cases or within school transmission cases there were as a result of that primary case in the school. And we did that by school, by week, in partnership between the schools, the researchers, and the local health department through contact tracing and testing. Now, this is the table that's publicly available, and it's the 11 school districts and the size of their school, the counties, the population of their counties, the size of their school staff, their number of students. All this was pre-pandemic numbers, very similar during the pandemic, and how many infections that they had, both primary and then how many secondary infections they had. Now, over the course of the pandemic, different questions would come up. So we had the original variant for SARS-CoV-2, then we had the Alpha variant in early 2021, and then we had the Delta variant come out during summer school of 2021. We also had questions about athletics and should we do quarantine? Should we do exclusion from school if you were exposed? And because we had the primary endpoint and various interventions already established and agreed upon and common definition and understanding of terms, we could look at one question after another in partnership with our schools, not only in North Carolina, but throughout the country. This was a paper from the summer of 2021 that had to do with the Delta variant. And you can see this light blue line. When the Delta variant came in to North Carolina in the midsummer or late June, early July, cases really started to take off in the community, and the amount of COVID acquired outside of school skyrocketed. But the amount of COVID acquired in school remained very, very low. And we were able to publish this and put it out into the public domain in September of 21, just from June, July, and August data. So by this time, our partnership with the schools was very, very smooth, and we were able to rapidly get data out into the public domain. We then started doing a series of subsequent studies where we worked with masking or no masking across 100 to 200 different school districts from throughout the country, from, you know, nine different states, looking at over 2 million children. And really, you can see that the green line is schools that did universal masking. The red line is schools that did completely optional masking. And then there was a group of schools that would do periodic masking, sometimes optional, sometimes required, depending on rates in the community. And masking, universal masking, really reduced the amount of transmission that was in schools by about 70 or 80%. Now, Matt, what masking does, obviously, is it gets you to a point where you can get children vaccinated, you can get your vulnerable children vaccinated, and then you can, once you have vaccine in place, you've got a combination of vaccine and natural immunity, you can kind of move on with your life and move away from masking all the time. And depending on the community in which you live, you might choose to never mask again. You might choose to only mask at the next pandemic. You might occasionally mask if it's a bad flu or RSV season. That might depend on you and your community, but we know that it works, and we know that if we have it system-wide as required, that we can really reduce transmission of a respiratory virus within schools. It's a tremendous privilege for us as a research group to be able to work with what amounted to, in the end, 200 different school districts across 9 or 10 states. And just the incredible breadth and depth of compassion and passion that our colleagues in public health and at academic medical centers and at schools, the families, the school staff, the teachers, the leadership, the superintendents, just was a real privilege for us to be of service to children. And it's really a testament to some of the things that we can get done if we work together and we think through, all right, really, what's the question here? The primary endpoint is transmission at school. Can we interrupt that by a simple intervention, for example, masking? And can we do that until a vaccine becomes available? And then we can all move on to a more routine conduct of education and participation in schools. With that, I thank you for your time.